Do you want to be tall? How about feared and respected? What if I told you that you could teleport from place to place? And there's only one catch. If you touch water, you could die. This is hardcore Minecraft, and I plan to survive 100 days as an Enderman. Also, follow me on Twitch and subscribe below, and you'll never miss out on anything. My three goals: number one, speedrun the game, defeating the dragon and making it back home. Number two, search through the end dimension for an elytra. And number three, build my very own end city. Now to claim another dimension as my own. Day one, as the world loaded in around me, I noticed that I had two full lines of hearts. After taking a moment of getting used to being three blocks tall, I went to search for my first tree to punch. After getting myself a wooden pickaxe, I went straight to digging down to get some cobblestone, and it was very disorienting being so tall. But soon enough, I had some stone tools, and then it was on to getting some food. For some reason, it didn't show my sword, so in third person, I looked just like a strong enderman that could kill any mob in two hits. Since one of my goals was to get an elytra, I knew that I would need some paper, so in my travels, I gathered all the sugarcane that I could find. And since I was close to the water, I felt a little curious and decided to dip my toes in. That was not a good idea. It had a similar effect to lava without the burning. Perhaps one of the coolest things about being an enderman is being able to teleport. I wanted to test out how accurate my abilities were, so I tried teleporting from lily pad to lily pad, and surprisingly, I didn't fall in. After making this tall hobbit hole, I started to cook all my food and spent the rest of the day collecting wood. I spent days 2 through 4 mining through caves in search for coal and iron, and most of the iron fell down this hole, but this did open up the opportunity for me to try teleporting downward, which in hindsight was probably not the smartest idea, but if I died, I was only on day 2 anyway. The scarier part was actually teleporting back up, and by the night of day 4, I had more than enough iron to build all the iron gear that I would need. I excitedly put on all my armor and my shield to see what I would look like, and I just looked like a normal enderman. On day 5, I went on the hunt for some cows. I think having a taller body means having a bigger stomach, because I was running out of food a little faster than normal. On day 6, like a true speedrunner, I went out and searched for a lava lake that I could turn into a nether portal. And after running around aimlessly, I stumbled upon this ruined nether portal. And while I was uncovering it, I was hit by something behind me. I turned around ready to fight, and it was just a cactus. When I turned back around, I grabbed the gold because I knew I would need it soon. I also found this chest that spawned with the portal. It had blocks of obsidian and a flint and steel inside. I rebuilt the portal and went to go light it, and it wasn't working. And that's when I realized that crying obsidian doesn't actually work for building a portal. Then I made another realization. Since I didn't have a diamond pickaxe, this was going to take forever to mine. Welp, I guess I'll see you in 200 days. Just kidding. Although it did get dark by the time I finished breaking that block. Once I actually finished the portal, I saw some light in the darkness, and upon investigation, I had finally found a lava pool. Right as soon as I finished building the portal, as I was warping to a different dimension, I kind of hoped that I would spawn in a warped forest, but we don't always get what we wish for. However, I was curious if a hoglin would attack me, but these hoglins were not too smart. Also, if your portal spawns in a crimson forest, please be careful of lava falls spawning in. While hoglins are not the brightest, they are very terrifying in packs. Luckily, as an enderman, you can teleport away from all of your problems. I spent the next couple days collecting some gold, and on day 11, I captured these two piglins to trade with, but we were rudely interrupted by all of these zombified piglins. One of my favorite things about playing as other mobs is the science experiments. Will drinking bottles of water hurt an enderman? Surprisingly not. In addition to getting some ender pearls from the piglins, I also got some spectral arrows, two things that I would need to defeat the dragon. Day 12 and 13, I spent trying to get some blaze rods, and let me just say, being able to teleport in Minecraft makes things so much easier. I was a little worried I wouldn't find any blaze at this stronghold because it was a little bare bones, get it? You're so short, I don't need you to laugh at my jokes. Next, I went to go pick on someone my own size and found out that I could stare at Endermen and they wouldn't attack me. After a little bit more exploring, I was so excited to find and kill my first blaze. After getting some more blaze rods on day 14, I was heading back to my portal when I came across this ravine. I feel like I saved so many blocks by not having to bridge across stuff like this and just being able to teleport over. I was so excited to get back to the overworld, and I was also excited to craft up Eyes of Ender so quick into a new world. This honestly might be the first time I ever speedrun Minecraft by myself. And with one throw of a pearl, there we go, I was off in search for a stronghold. I spent days 15 and 16 following the pearls when I came across this pillager outpost. I was definitely cautious as I got closer to the outpost, but the pillagers knew better than trying to shoot at an enderman. You can always use more food, so I grabbed these bales of hay and then headed over to the tower. A lot of things in Minecraft Minecraft are just not built for Endermen. I had to dig my way into the tower, as well as to get access to each floor. It definitely seemed a lot smaller and warmer than I remember, but all the effort to get to the top of the tower was definitely worth it. I found a crossbow, arrows, and a couple bottles of enchanting. On a nearby beach, I found some sugarcane, and when I threw my next Eye of Ender, it went down into the sand. I got the different tools together that I would need to dig down to find the stronghold, and when I actually started digging down, I felt like I missed the stronghold. Let me know down in the comments if this has ever happened to you. I pillared back up to the surface, feeling a little defeated. I threw down another Eye of Ender and found a new place to dig, and this time I finally found the stronghold. I realized pretty quickly that this stronghold was a little messed up, but it did make it a little easier to loot, especially being able to teleport around. I found some paper I could use to make rockets, and this enchanted book with pretty good enchants. I spent day 17 searching through the stronghold and taking all the loot that I could find. On day 18, I stumbled across the portal room, and it was actually pretty close to where I came in at. I must have made a pretty big circle. I was a little too tall to get into the room, so I had to teleport in. I'll be honest, as I was putting the Eyes of Ender into the portal, I realized I normally fight the dragon with diamond armor, so I hoped the extra hearts would keep me alive. And with the portal lit, I returned to my home dimension, but I couldn't celebrate quite yet. The dragon fight had begun. If you can't tell, I'm the Enderman with arrows flying out of its face whilst getting attacked by the dragon. I pretty easily took out the smaller towers, but I usually have a lot more arrows. So just to be safe, I was going to pillar up the taller towers, and I thought I could teleport up and catch myself putting a block underneath me. But after that didn't work, I started bridging up like normal when the dragon hit me off the tower and into the air. Luckily, with some quick thinking, I teleported to the ground. With the help of my fellow Enderman, we got that dragon's health down, and I waited for just the right moment to get the last few hits on it, defeating the dragon and freeing the End Dimension from her rule. I ended day 18 by grabbing myself a little trophy. On day 19, I made myself a little hole for me to hide in so I could safely kill a couple Endermen and get myself a few Ender Pearls to go through the gateway. I didn't really want to risk using my teleport ability because I didn't know how different it was from a pearl and I didn't want to throw myself off the edge. And once I went through the portal, I was right on the edge. What would you say is the scariest thing in Minecraft? To me, it's bridging over the void. I wandered these barren wastelands as a starving Enderman because I used the last of my food during the dragon fight. I also took advantage of my teleporting ability, and I was so relieved to see an end city render in the distance. I learned two things that day. This specific end city did not have an elytra, and not a single end city has food, just beet seeds. I was still happy to find diamonds and some pretty good gear, but none of it would matter if I couldn't make it back to the overworld before starving to death. And then on day 21, I did like how easy it was to teleport down from the end city, and I pretty much spent that whole day teleporting so I could make it back to the gateway before starving. Battered, broken, and running on empty, I made it back to the portal and jumped through. I was so glad to survive with just 1.5 hunger bars left. And I also remembered that I accomplished my first goal and actually beat the dragon speedrunning Minecraft. When I made it to the overworld, I immediately went to go kill this chicken, and that's when I realized I forgot to set the spawn in the stronghold. I didn't even think to, because if I die, it's all over anyway. But you teleport to your respawn point. Luckily, I did save the coordinates to the stronghold. I spent the rest of day 21 just killing all the animals that I could find. Day 22, I put all my food in the furnace and spent that day and the next day collecting some wood. And on the night of day 23, it started to rain. So I had to teleport from tree to tree, trying to make it back to my crafting table so I could make myself a bed. Then I slept right through the storm. On the morning of day 24, it was time to go on an adventure and start heading back to the stronghold portal. I had a lot of fun teleporting through the biomes and exploring the world. I figured I could take some time to collect some different resources, including some more sugarcane. And that's when I realized that my boots had Frostwalker on it. These were very helpful for avoiding getting in the water. I really love being able to teleport in Minecraft. You can move around so much more quickly and get to a lot of places without having to dig down, bridge across, or build up. I came across this cool little village hidden in the forest, although the villagers weren't too happy about me breaking and entering. Since my second goal was to get an elytra, I figured I might as well get myself a mending book and an unbreaking 3 book for my elytra. I gathered up all this wheat to trade with farmers to get some emeralds to buy the books. And I guess the wandering trader heard that the stonks were going up in this village because he showed up wanting a piece of the profits. So just to be nice, I bought a few gunpowder off of him. On day 27, I headed down into a nearby cave to collect some iron that I could use to craft an anvil now that I had a few things in my inventory that I could combine. And by the night of day 28, I had a better enchanted helmet and a pretty good enchanted chestplate. Day 29, I kept exploring and I came across this cool desert village. village. They didn't have too much good loot, but I did take all of their hay. What did make their village really cool was their proximity to this buried desert temple. So this is where they are hiding all their good loot. Diamonds, horse armor, golden apples, gunpowder, and saddle, amongst a few other good things. And on the night of day 30, I found another desert temple. This one didn't have as good as loot, but I did remember this time to grab the TNT. And as I headed out of the desert temple, the sun began to rise on a nearby village. After collecting all of their wheat, I put some of my things into a chest so I could have a little bit more room for trading. And I must say, this was a pretty busy village for being in the middle of the desert. After I was all done trading, I did steal their lectern from the library. As the sun began to set on day 31, I found myself an all black horse to match my Enderman style. And Endermen look really silly riding on a horse. As I was searching for one last village to loot and get the enchantment books I needed, I pulled this high IQ move and made this cool ice bridge to ride my horse across. Unfortunately, as soon as I made it across, it started raining. I really like how it stops raining when you sleep through the night. On day 32, I realized that I had gone way off track from my path to the stronghold when I came across this jungle. I still wanted to explore it, but I knew my horse couldn't go with me. And I didn't realize it then, but this was actually the last time I saw my horse. Because, like most people do, I got lost in the jungle. I did make sure though to grab some bamboo that I could use for scaffolding and some melons that I could make a farm with. It was pretty exciting to find this jungle temple, but I did not want to have to deal with all the traps as an Enderman. It was already hard enough just to get inside the temple. So I went straight for the loot, and this is all that I found. On the night of day 33, I made it to the other end of the jungle and found this quaint little village. And I guess they didn't have enough beds because these villagers were trying to sleep in the troughs. While they did have a little loot, they didn't have any hay for me to steal. Trade with. On day 34, I came across one last village to raid. Wow, old habits do die hard. I extorted as much emeralds as I could from the villagers, crafted another lectern, and spent the next few days trapped in this house with this family of villagers. And I was not going to leave until one of them sold me a mending book and the other sold me an Unbreaking 3 book. Once I got what I came for, I broke out of their house and ran away trying to get as far away from the village as possible. I really hate trading with villagers. Now it was time to take a direct route straight to the coordinates of the stronghold, which made me take a scary trip over the ocean. If my boat broke over the water, I can almost guarantee that I would have died. Of course, no trip is not complete without a stop for a sugary snack. Also, here's a little tip if you're gonna play as an Enderman. Don't teleport too much in the savannah because there's a lot of random holes with pools of water in them. And here's where I realized that I really did go in a big circle. I was coming towards this pillager tower from a completely different way, but I thought maybe it was a different outpost. Then I saw that their practice targets were missing their hay bales, which the pillager said another Enderman stole like 20 days ago. After quickly leaving the premises, I made it back to the little beach where the stronghold was. I was so hyped to find out that I could just teleport straight down into the stronghold. I was about to go mining when I realized I didn't have any torches or coal. I forgot them in a furnace somewhere in the world. To add insult to injury, my pickaxe broke while mining. So I headed back up and tried to find the portal room. I made sure to set my spawn. I finally got to unload all my inventory into a chest, and I crafted myself a diamond pickaxe. I wanted to build myself a sugarcane farm, but to do that, I would need some redstone. So while I was collecting some, I made sure to mine at diamond level, and I actually managed to find a few. On day 42, if I could teleport down into the stronghold, I could teleport back to the surface. But it does hurt a little bit more going up. This guy again. And no good trades this time. I spent a good bit of the day collecting dirt because I figured I could use it for more things other than my sugarcane farm. Sugarcane needs water to grow, so I crafted up some buckets, and while I was heading out into the night to collect some water, I saw a beautiful moonrise over this island of pigs. In hindsight, I probably should have just took off my boots when trying to collect water. I spent the next 2 days turning that little hole I hid from Enderman in into a full-fledged sugarcane farm. I just needed a little bit of quartz so I could make some observers, and then the farm would be finished. On day 45, I needed to get ready to go end busting, so I collected myself up some food, made myself some rockets, grabbed the enchantment books, and planted some bamboo, just like anyone else would do before end busting. I don't know, it seemed important at the time. I also made sure to grab some cobblestone to bridge between the end islands. Then it was off into the end wilderness, never to return again. Okay, I'd actually make it back in like less than 10 days. See, the cobblestone did come in handy, and I found myself an end city. Unfortunately, it was one of the smallest end cities I've ever found. It almost wasn't worth even going into, but I did want to collect some shulker shells. I got a little bit more lazy when exploring, so whenever I could, I would just pillar up and try to teleport across. Watching it back, it probably wasn't the safest plan. And nothing is sweeter than seeing an endship render in the distance. This time, I carefully bridged over. I got myself some sweet health potions and completed my second goal of getting an elytra. Another pro tip, take the chests while end busting so you can use them to make shulker boxes. I threw the enchants on my elytra and now I was an enderman with wings. That's actually a pretty terrifying thought. Shulker boxes are so OP and I'm only like 50 days into this world. Luckily, before I started collecting more shulker shells, I realized that I did not have a shield. So after crafting one up, I looted the rest of this giant end city. As I flew away from that conquered city, I figured it would be easier to find a new gateway. And I think if you fly north or south from an end city, you'll find other end cities and gateways. Another fun tip for you. While the nether is dangerous, I feel like I'd be much more likely to die exploring the end, so I was so happy to make it back to the overworld. I was so focused on trying to complete my goals that I kept running out of food. Ponder back and remember these peaceful pigs picnicking in the pearlescent moonlight? Yeah, they gon' die. Okay, I couldn't bring myself to killing all of them, so I left two alive so we can repopulate the island later. Although I did go around killing all the other types of animals unforgivingly. I spent the rest of day 55 cooking up all the meat that I had gathered and collecting endstone while I waited for my food to heat up. I spent day 56 through 58 making myself a better entrance to the stronghold. I wanted to make it look like the end dimension was taking over the overworld. I also wanted to make a nice staircase leading down straight to the end portal. You could tell that I was a pretty happy enderman. My next expedition was a lot of effort for just a few simple things. I wanted to find both a swamp and a village. Luckily, I found both right next to each other. As you may have noticed, I continued to run out of food, and I did not want to eat rotten flesh. So I brought the rest of my emeralds with me and bought as much bread as I could. I spent the next couple days there, and at night I would hunt for slime, and during the day I was trying to find different ways to get as much food as I could. Luckily, as I traded with the farmer villager, I unlocked pumpkins, which means I could sell all of these pumpkins in the village to the farmer, and in turn get some more food. And just to be safe, I hunted their entire population of sheep. On day 63, I made it back to my base with a ton of food, and now you can finally see what I was collecting slime for. I crafted all the slime into blocks and placed them at the bottom of my staircase. I teleported up to the top and jumped on down. My base was the perfect mixture of creepy and fun. Also, hopefully now I wouldn't fall to my death. I spent day 64 through 67 gathering up as much endstone as I could. I used all my enchanted pickaxes that I found in the end cities, went back home, made myself a diamond pickaxe, and went back to mining. I also wanted to make this look like a natural cave just in case I decided to build something in it. On day 68, I turned the lava underneath the portal into obsidian to get one last block to be able to build a nether portal. But I had no way to light it and no flint, so I went to a nearby river and I probably should have took off my boots again, but I eventually got a single piece of gravel that I just kept punching until it turned into flint. I went through the portal and I spawned in the most perfect place. And with iron buckets in hand, I collected 10 buckets of lava. Why would I need so much? Well, to make the purpur blocks, you actually need to smelt chorus fruit. So I spent the next 3 days collecting and smelting some chorus fruit. And here's a pretty cool time lapse of it. I also gathered chorus flowers from the top of the plants so I could grow even more chorus fruit. And then I surrounded my farm with a nice little fence. Even though I try to be an enderman of science, I'm definitely not the smartest one. I tried to go scuba diving in a coral reef to try to catch some tropical fish for my base, and I nearly died several times. I don't know why, out of all the fish, I tried to get puffer fish. Luckily, I had a few golden apples on me. Speaking of science experiments, while I was researching everything about the chorus plant, the Minecraft wiki informed me that when foxes eat chorus fruit, they teleport. I had to put this to the test. I found a fox in a giant spruce forest and gave him a chorus fruit, and he was actually pretty hard to keep up with, but since I was able to teleport, I managed to keep up with him. Eventually, I saw some purple particles, but I'm not sure if he actually teleported, but with the second chorus fruit that I gave him, he poofed away. I really love when Mojang adds in these little details. On day 77, I returned home, jumped down into my stronghold, grabbed whatever I needed for my little base, and headed back into the nether. After cooking chorus fruit, you can combine popped chorus with blaze rods to craft end rods. So I spent the next couple days fighting blaze until I had about a stack of blaze rods. The fortress also led to a warped forest, so I spent day 82 collecting warping vines, and I spent the next couple days gathering the blue wart blocks and getting shroom lights, all things that I wanted to use for my final base. I also grabbed a little bit of quartz to use to craft an observer and finish my sugarcane farm. farm. Since the sugarcane didn't grow too much on the main end island, I probably should have built it where I was going to build the rest of my base, which was through this gateway. I wanted to build my base in the outer end islands, just like where you'd find all the other end cities. I really enjoyed building this elegant bridge and this nice little platform to spawn on when I'm coming back from the overworld. Now I had myself a grand entrance to the main island, which was really close to where I built my chorus farm, and I also cleared this nice little plot of land to build my end city. Next, I wanted to light up the place a little better, so I designed this nice little lamppost and added some end rods under my bridge. I kind of like how the end rods look like they're holding up the bridge, which you'll see me implement a little bit more very soon. Now, it didn't take me 8 whole days to build these lampstands. Most of that time was spent building this. My end city design was inspired by many cultures put together. I added balconies, curved roofs, a lot of places for ships to dock, and some really cool windows and doors, while hopefully still staying true to that vanilla end city feel. But of course, those boat docks would not be complete without some boats. I wanted to design some new boats for Endermen to be able to use, and since they're tall like elves, I went for elven type boats. Just imagine if you're exploring the end in a new update, and you saw these types of boats flying over your head, and then came across this beautiful end city, and that bridge in the distance would be very helpful. I also thought it'd be cool if Endermen had little gondolas, and use long end rods to push themselves and sail through the sky. This was my first time speedrunning Minecraft by myself. I also accomplished my goal of getting an elytra, and on day 100, I designed myself a new biome for the end dimension. Thanks to Luke the Notable for coming up with the 100 days trend, to you for watching, and to my patrons for your continued support. I'd like to invite you to come hang out with me on Twitch sometime, and follow me on other social media, because I'm active on them as well. You can find everything you need in the description, and thank you again for watching.